You're right. Well, hello, good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this, the final plenary roundtable for the Climate Smart Chefs Roadmap to the Vision 2030. It's been an exciting journey. I'm very excited to have so many people here today to share with you what we've done to date, the guidelines that have been created, and to go over the next steps as well. And we also have a fantastic panel to discuss this process with you as well. So thank you and welcome. So go on to the next slide, please. Just a gentle reminder about what we've been doing. The roadmap to Vision 2030, we held our first plenary roundtable in October. This was culmination of a year of preparation work for this the Life Climate Smart Chefs Roadmap process, which is a 3-year project kindly funded by Life and the European Union. The first plenary roundtable was to set out the problem, what we were doing, where we were going. Since then, we have held three specific workshops. What the first was looking at the challenges and opportunities around sustainable diets, technology, and food waste. The next was to outline what are some of the opportunities that are presented by these challenges, and how particularly chefs, but other stakeholders, can start identifying them to take action. And the third topic, roundtable was focusing on what these individual sectors can do, what are the guidelines they would like to have, primarily for policymakers at local, national, and regional level. But they were also to talk around what others can do. So what can restaurants do? What can chefs do personally? And just as importantly, what can the customers do? Because recognizing that change is a multi-stakeholder process, and it's not all down to the policymakers to do everything, though they very much can deliver and facilitate the change. And this led to our final plenary roundtable, which is here today, where I'm going to discuss, give you a quick overview of the guidelines that have been agreed so far by the participants, for you to give your feedback on, which will be included in the report Vision 2030. Next slide, please. So here is today's agenda. I'm doing the welcome at the moment. Normally, Marta Antonelli would give you a quick overview of the project, but I'm going to be doing that as well because Marta is ill. She's also got a very young baby who's absolutely gorgeous, so she can't join us today. Then you'll have more of me, so I do apologize for that, where you'll have 10 minutes where I will go over the guidelines. I'll give you a very quick overview, so you can understand where we are and how we've done it. And then once I've given you the guidelines, I'm going to step back, and for 15 minutes, you'll get an overview on each of the thematic leads: sustainable healthy diets from Selene, Barbara will look at food waste, and Karen will look at technology tools for chefs. It'll be fast, it'll be dynamic. I know how brilliant they are, so we've got great things to look forward to then. And then the project manager, Will Nicholson, is going to take over for 25 minutes, and we will have a fantastic roundtable discussion. He will be chairing it. We'll have Julia from the WWF European Policy Office in Brussels, David, for the former Food Trails project manager at the Bergamo Municipality, and Susan Neal, the head of sustainability at the Compass Group. So a really diverse group to hear different opinions about what we can do and have a discussion. And then I will finalize by telling you what next, because this isn't the end of it, this is the end of the beginning, but we still have another 18 months this project to go, and after that we will still have another 6 years to fix the food system. So I'm very excited by that. So if we go on to the next part, we finish this slide, I will. So yeah, just a reminder, technical guidelines: if you can't hear us speaking, please check your computer speakers, headsets are not muted, click on the audio settings, which speakers and headset you have active in Zoom. If you have any technical difficulties during the round table, click leave and rejoin it on the link you receive through your email. Your microphone, video, and chat function are enabled, so please do feel free, particularly when the opportunity arises, to participate, to join in, and the chat function uses anytime. We want to hear your feedback. We want to know your thoughts on this. It's really important. And this webinar is going to be recorded. The video will be made available online at the Life Climate Smart Chefs website, which I'm sure you've all visited. Okay, so I'm now going to stop sharing that, please. I will now give you a quick overview of the project. So I'm going to share my screen for this. We go. Let's give it a second to come up. So I'm assuming we can all see that. I'm sharing my screen. So what is the Life Climate Smart Chef? This is a European project that has received funding from the Life Programme of the European Union. Its aim is to contribute to the development and implementation of the EU climate policy and the farm to fork strategy. So what we're doing on this project, it's a new approach. It's not been done before. And we are actively involving European chefs, whether it's a chef at a Michelin-starred restaurant, an apprentice at a school kitchen, or chefs working for some of the biggest caterers in the world. But we are actively involving chefs from every area within the food system to become promoters of low emission, nutritious and affordable foods. We are covering the areas of food waste, sustainable diets and technology, and we're very much trying to co-create the solutions for this. We are doing this by providing chefs with the knowledge and the tools to generate change, both in their own work. We are working with chefs to create tools for recipe design, for menu planning, how they can communicate this with their customers, but also with their suppliers as well. So we recognize that chefs are very much sort of in the center of this, and they are in a unique position. They can speak to suppliers, manufacturers, but they can also speak to their customers. And they can really demonstrate that change is possible through their actions. And one of the things that is very exciting around this is a lot of the debate around food is when it happens and people talk about food sustainability, people say it's going to be boring. We haven't already eaten like this. It's not that exciting. And what we genuinely believe through this, and we know it, is that chefs, by becoming the center of this, can demonstrate that these changes are affordable, they're nutritious, and they're delicious. And they absolutely are. And I've been fortunate. I've worked with some of these chefs. I've tried some of the food. It's amazing what they are doing. And that is a really exciting tool. And what we want to do is to promote the mainstream debate on food as a key factor in climate change mitigation. And the project activities include high level training for chefs. We're going to develop a digital tool to design menus. We're also in the process of creating an award dedicated to climate smart chefs. This is really exciting. This is going to keep going on beyond the end of the project, but it's very exciting. And then we are creating an EU network of chef associations who can keep escalating this work, developing this work, who can really get into their national markets and the regional markets, and maybe go beyond the EU, because some of these chef associations will naturally be global in their reach. And then the final part of this project, which we're coming to sort of the culmination of at the moment, is this work, the Life Climate Smart Chefs Vision 2030. And this is a strategic paper which will be aimed at providing policy guidelines and recommendations to local level, national level, and to the EU to really try and influence change, because we feel that there's a need now for guidance coming from people from the EU, and they need to listen to people acting on the ground. And we think these guidelines, as they're created by chefs, they're created by food service, it's something that the EU should listen to. So what do these guidelines look like? That's what I'm here to explain to you now, because we have spent a lot of time going into them, and I have created. And so what we have is some guidelines for chefs. I hope you can see this. Good. So I'm just going to get this up now. So yes, so what's happened, as I briefly discussed, we have been developing the roadmap for creating these guidelines. I mentioned it earlier, it's been going on since October, the 12th of October precisely. And this is the fifth and last roundtable that we are having on these. They have got three thematic sessions: healthy and sustainable diets, food waste, and technology tools for chefs. And all of this is going to contribute to a report that we are going to publish during the midterm conference on July the 5th. We've had many participants. Yes, the participant numbers have changed across each plenary and workshop, but this is what you'd expect. But it's been really good. It's been a diverse range of participants. They've covered all areas from NGOs to business to chefs to policymakers. It has been a really good and dynamic process, and it has been a very much a case of we have been led by the participants into what we create and how we develop these guidelines to make sure that we have been listening, because we have not come to this with a preordained set of guidelines. We needed to know what were the right ones for yourselves, which is what we've done. So we've divided the guidelines for policymakers into four subsections. I'll very quickly go over them, but I won't read them all. So the first one is food system changes. These are the really big ones, recognizing that the current food system is not sustainable and it's not a food system that is set up to deliver the changes we need. It's a food system, and a lot of the discussions came about with this. It's a food system that's set up to support the status quo. And it's clear the status quo is not going to deliver the changes needed at the pace of change we need, particularly if we're going to deliver things like the Green Deal, the farm to fork strategy, and some of the fantastic initiatives happening, say, at cities that we're seeing developing. So what we came up with this, or the participants did, is policymakers need to be clear about the role of dietary transition and food waste production in climate and food system strategies. That's in there because at the moment they've tended to avoid a lot of this and they're focused very much on production measures. Policymakers should facilitate the transitions of chefs into buying more sustainably produced food and adapting new technology. It came up repeatedly that chefs feel that they're time poor, they're challenged. It's not easy to learn about new technology. It's not easy to get the training, etc. So they need this sort of help. And policymakers on a very macro level should support the production of more sustainable food. It's got to be made affordable and accessible. And the agricultural policies need to be updated. They need to change so that they support the increased production of low carbon sustainable food that delivers sustainable diets. And also part of this is reevaluate the role of livestock products throughout the food system, including restaurants. And when we do that, we should support holistic sustainable production practices. And this particular area came up in almost every single conversation we've had. The next sector we looked at was looking at guidelines for restaurant sector, how they need support and the finances. And we know that restaurants will need financial support in some method to help them reduce the cost burden of any change, and also to support things like cross-sector collaboration and increase understanding of the benefits for chefs and restaurants of this transition. It's still not very clear. It's still a very opaque system. And again, we know that the restaurants and food service run on very low margins and they're very time poor. We need to also have clearer and better policies around incentives, what the funding is, what are the grants that are in place. Because again, conversations have come up, people don't know what's out there, they don't know how to do it. And when they do, it's never that clear how to do it. So we need the EU to get better at this and to really simplify the process, to really deliver at the pace of change we need. And that brings to the fact that policymakers need the right systems in place to promote better management of restaurants. And then finally, government can financially support test kitchens and pilot tests of restaurants, because these things can't all happen in a bubble in theory. We need practical examples. And this is something where you can't expect restaurants or kitchens to do on their own. There needs to be support for it, or they can be set up to demonstrate what can happen. There's lots of opportunities for that. But yes, government needs to step up and deliver on this. So the other two sections we've got, one is on restaurant sector standards and regulation. So these were very clear. I mean, again, an area that came up repeatedly, and it does cross everything, was the need for mandatory public procurement criteria for food that is focused on environment and social sustainability and health. And the reason for this is the mandatory public procurement is when it's voluntary, it doesn't always work. If it's, we have the minimum mandatory requirements for healthy, sustainable food, that is brilliant. That means that'll make sure the chefs and the people working system know what they have to do. It creates a level playing field. It'll mean producers know what level they have to produce their food to supply it, so they have a guaranteed market. And the other the bonus of this is we then know that the food coming out is guaranteed to be healthy, and the people who receive it, whether people living in care homes, hospitals, government canteens, the army, police force, schools, they're getting a really healthy meal every time that's sustainable. And that is a really strong output of this. We also need clear set of standards and incentives to help chefs adopt technology and to measure and reduce their food waste. They're not there at the moment. So we need to, it needs to be in place to help people move forward. So again, you have a level playing field and the people at the bottom step up and become better. You need to support collaborative initiatives because collaboration is going to be absolutely key. We can't work in a bubble. So let people share information, share data, share knowledge. And that way everyone can learn from what is best. And again, this can be enhanced through the sharing and use of creation of data platforms between restaurants, companies and governments. We know the value of data, particularly in this connected world at the moment. And then the final area that came up, which we hadn't actually planned for, but it came up really, really strongly in every single conversation from the very beginning, was the role of education. And education happens at three levels. One, governments need to include education around food systems throughout the current school curriculum from primary onwards. Very, very, very few governments do. And it's not just about cooking. It can be the history of food. Where does food come from? So if you're looking at the tomato, we know it came from 1492 in Columbus. If you want to look where sugar comes from, sugar is not a European crop. You want to even go back as far as chickens. Chickens are not endemic to Europe. So you could put it in history. You can teach geography through food. But we need to really start teaching food and the preparation of food and the growing of food, healthy eating at every level of school. It is possible, but it's missing at the moment. And everybody seems to agree this would be a game changer if we knew where our food was coming from. We knew the history of it and we were engaged in it. Governments should also mandate to complete food sustainability training throughout the hospitality and restaurant sector. In culinary schools, so it's part of everyone's training, whatever it is. As an aside, it could also be included in all medical training as well, because we know many doctors and nurses aren't taught about nutrition either, or it's a very minor part of it. But it needs to be mandated so that the culinary schools and other trainers have to teach about food sustainability. The tools are being developed, we are through this project, so it's really important. And then finally, governments could financially support the cooperation of chefs with schools. So chefs are not doing it off their own back. They don't lose financially. They can actually go in and help schools. They can teach kids everything from the preparation of food, how to how to prepare food, what a sustainable dish looks like, I don't know, to how to grow, prepare vegetables you've just picked from the ground, how to sort of deal with sort of meat and dairy, etc. There's all kinds of things that could happen in there. So education was a key theme that came out again and again. So that is the guidelines we have for you. And again, over the course of today, please put any thoughts in the chat. There'll also be a chance to join in the discussion as well. But it's been a really great process and I've loved being a part of it. Well, I've worked on sustainable diets since 2008 and this has been one of the most exciting things I've been involved in and shows how much the discussion has moved along. So I'm going to sort of, I'm sure you've heard enough of me. So I'm now going to hand over to the people who led the process, who've led the different sections of the workshop. And so I'm going to hand over to Selene, who will talk you through the sustainable diets work. So Selene, please, over to you.
Okay, here we are. I'm going to share a few slides. I won't read them all, but just for you to follow better. Can you see my screen now?
Yes, we can. Yes.
Okay. You will see that in our sustainable diets workshop, we came up with some recommendations that we already So in the guidelines that Duncan was showing now. We divided them into sub-teams, like functional recommendations. For example, sustainability should be more present in general in restaurants and part of businesses' DNA of all the food system, and not an addition, an add-on. And sustainability should become like food safety and health. So everyone's responsibility should be automatically included everywhere. For doing this, we need support for cooperation among different actors in the food system. And we should also develop policies to account for the true cost of food. That means including also the environmental cost of it. From the business and economic point of view, policies to give more economic support to plant-based products is needed, and also to support collaboration and knowledge sharing. Moving to political recommendations, many of them are already part of the guidelines, but in practice, we need to translate knowledge into practice through experiments, like different kinds of financial incentives, also because the catering sector is very diverse, and we should not only include only large actors, but also small businesses. Agricultural policies, subsidies, and financial supports should be directed also to plant-based products and to food produced in a sustainable way. And this transition to a sustainable food system should be supported by the EU policies, as we already said. Also, we already talked about the mandatory public food procurement criteria. This should be very helpful. And moving to the last part, chefs and customers are two key actors, and we focused deeply on how education of these two actors is very relevant. So about chefs, a continuous training about sustainability is a key element. And we should also create and support opportunities for learning, not only through theory, but also through practice, like workshops. Diversity should be taken into account because chefs work and come from very different contexts, and support peer-to-peer learning and enabling space for reflection is another part. All this cooperation and interaction between different actors should be supported also from a financial point of view. And moving to customers, the main theme that came out from our workshops was education, different forms of education of customers in order to make them more prepared, more understanding towards new knowledge on sustainability, new menus, in order they can better understand what chefs are doing behind the scenes. This is my part.
Brilliant. Thank you so much. That was really good. Really good run through of everything we've learned. So thank you, Celine. We're now going to pass over to Barbara, who's going to discuss food waste with you.
Thank you, Duncan. I'm not using any slides, but I think that much that was said by Selene applies also to the food waste sessions that we had. On the one hand, we have the need for more sustainable food because of the impact that it has. On the other hand, we also need affordable food, but let me say that very cheap food can also bring to food waste, especially in households. So what is, in this case, the role of chefs? They should lead spotlight how to use food in a more sustainable way also. So circularity is one of the keywords to use in this sense. And on the other hand, we should also have more bridges between the different segments in the food value chain. But regarding what can policymakers could do to support more sustainable restaurants in the sense that leading to more sustainable use of food, the focus should be set more on the prevention of food waste. So with those solutions that help chefs and let me say also the restaurant staff, not only chefs, to adopt those solutions which can actually prevent the generation of food waste. But then, so technical solutions, both in the sense of technology, but also in the sense of adopting the right behavior in your work environment. Secondly, less technical aspect, but very relevant also for the food waste prevention, is good communication inside the restaurant among the different members of the staff. This is also very important. Thirdly, also technology in the strict sense can bring to good solutions to prevent food waste. But this raises an aspect of the affordability of the technical solutions. So it's very important that policymakers incentivize or try to help all types of restaurants to adopt technical solutions in order to prevent food waste, like solutions that help in the management of the restaurant, including from purchase until the management of customers, but also help chefs to measure their performance in the good usage of food products. Then we have also a focus on customers' education. It's very important that customers do not focus on on always the same plates, let's say, or very big menus which offer a wide range of recipes, but they can gradually appreciate any new types of menus of that, like those with more sustainable food products, but also those menus which adopt a circular vision of the menu. Also, at the end of the day, we should also consider that we can bring leftovers home without feeling uneasy when asking for the so-called doggy bag. So these are all important aspects where good policy measures could make the difference. Finally, it's also very important that chefs are able to communicate outside their values and their engagement in preventing food waste, because they can show the way to their customers of how to adopt simple strategies in their everyday lives in food consumption, and thus generating less food waste and hopefully avoid it completely. So this is all on my side.
Thank you so much, Barbara. That's absolutely fascinating, really good to hear, very comprehensive. Thank you. And now Karen, over to you to complete the triumvirate.
Thanks, Duncan. Hi, everyone. So yeah, we hosted three roundtable discussions and they were aimed at gathering feedback on the challenges and opportunities of using technology in the workplace. Similar to the other sessions, we looked at three common themes. So they were functional challenges and opportunities, business and economic challenges and opportunities, and finally, political challenges and opportunities. So we found that the challenges identified really revolved around the lack of knowledge towards technology among the chefs. Also, the implementation of technology was seen as time-consuming and expensive. Political obstacles included the lack of support from government officials and difficulties in accessing grants. We also identified some interesting opportunities. So we said that improved integration on kitchen systems can enhance operational efficiencies, and waste technologies can be incorporated into menu engineering systems. We said that technology can optimize timing, improve customer and employee experiences, and boost profitability. So the recommendations then were grouped into three themes. So there were functional recommendations, which included clear information and an accessible path to funding, grants, and learning resources, and collaboration of data between restaurants, companies, governments, etc. Then under the business and economic recommendations, we had investment and subsidies need to facilitate the change to more environmental practices. Under the political recommendations, we had financial contributions need to be considered, and incentives for governments to invest are clear. So we had some examples like case studies from sustainable cities. Under the chef's recommendations, then we had that training and keeping up to date with new technology is super important, and also that nutritional factors should be considered when formulating recipes. So we were saying sustainable diet as well as a sustainable planet. And finally, under customer recommendations, our key points were social, economic, and nutritional factors need to be considered and not just environmental. And similarly to the other themes, the importance of educating customers. So thanks, that was a brief overview of our recommendations from the Technology for Tools.
Brilliant, again, thank you so much, Karen. That was great. So I think you'd agree, we've just had a really good overview of what each of the sessions came out with, the process we went through, and in the time we had, which was less than 15 minutes, it's been a really good summary. There'll be a lot more details on that when we publish the report at the midterm conference. So that's a great chance for you to look at it and learn more about them. But I'm now going to hand over to Will, who's going to chair the debate and our discussion. And I really would urge you to start using the chat box, some people already have, to ask any questions that come up, because this is a great opportunity to ask questions and also to contribute to it, because we're still open to people's ideas. So Will, over to you.
Thanks, Duncan. Hi, everyone. Nice to see you all. We're coming to sort of the latter stages of this part of the project. So next 25 minutes or so, we're going to kick around these ideas and the guidelines and get some expert input into how actually you can make this happen. How do you engage with policymakers to actually get them to pay attention to these sorts of guidelines? So we're very lucky to have with us three experts from across the spectre, really, in the food system. So firstly, Giulio Riedo is the European Agricultural and Food Sustainability Policy Officer for WWF, that's Worldwide Fund for Nature. Susan Meal is the Regional Sustainability Director for Europe and the Middle East for Compass Group. Compass Group are one of the world's biggest food service providers, contract caterers, as I'm sure many of you know. And David Adsari is Food Policy Officer for the environmental NGO Essere Animali, and has also worked, I hope I pronounced that bit right, David, has also worked a lot in food policy for other NGOs and city regions in the past in Italy. So we've got a really great set of expertise there. So in a little bit, I'm going to shut up and do some listening, but just to set the scene before we get going, these guidelines seem to sort of be based around food system issues, such as changing the subsidies around food to make sustainable food more appealing and available and so on and so forth, and making sure chefs are part of those decisions as a key stakeholder. Then there are more kind of almost business orientated things around financial incentives for restaurants and chefs, funding for them, test labs and innovation to help them. And then there are maybe the sort of the more gritty stuff around standards, guidelines, reporting frameworks, and importantly, better environmental data to help decision-making for chefs. So I hope I've not mangled that too much, but those seem like the main spaces. So I've got two questions for each of you. firstly, do you feel the guidelines are about right? Is there anything we're missing there? And secondly, and maybe sort of the real bit that I have no idea how we would go about this, is how can NGOs, food businesses, smaller organisations, individual chefs, how can they go about getting these guidelines in front of policymakers at the EU level, at the national level, at the city level, and so on and so forth? Because the world's seen a lot of reports making recommendations and guidelines. And what we're really interested in is how you get action to come out of those. So I will hand over. If it's okay, Julia, I'll go with you first, if that's okay. I'm picking it entirely randomly. So your face is the first one I saw. Over to you.
Hi. Thanks a lot, Willie. So for me, it was, thanks a lot for inviting me again. And it was a real pleasure to go through the guidelines that you have prepared during the workshops. And one of the things that really stood out for me was the role that the chef can play in influencing cultural norms. So I think this is one of the first way that you can implement guidelines, actually, by really cooking and using your creativity to try to shift towards more sustainable diet, and to offer to consumers and try to educate them to try something different and expose them also to something that they are not really used to, but without maybe disregarding totally the tradition. So I think the education role that really chef can play and influencing also cultural habits, I think it is very important. Then I was also very happy to see that the guidelines have many elements in common of with our position paper on the sustainable food system law. I remember I mentioned it already this autumn. So it's a law that I'm sure you are aware of. It has been under discussion for almost 1 year now. It's in a drafting process. And as WWF, we are trying to support it and to support the commission to have this law published. And for example, some elements that we have in common and we are really pushing for that are similar to what you included in the guidelines are, for example, the realignment of the subsidies toward sustainable food production and sustainable food consumption. And also the role that member states can play, the EU member states can play. What we are asking is basically that the European Commission will include some provision that we requires member states to increase, to use all the policy tools that they have, including fiscal policies and welfare scheme, for example, to increase the production and the consumption of sustainable food. So I think that there are many elements in common with your guidelines. So well done. And I'm really happy that also Chef share our vision. And we will definitely keep supporting and advocating for those ideas. And concretely, for example, how NGOs and I can speak for NGOs, but what we generally do is trying to raise awareness with the public, but try to really get in touch with policymakers directly by meeting them. And also what we are trying to do as WWF, I think is a bit of the particularity of WWF as NGO, is to try to find synergy as much as possible with business as well. So for example, lately we promoted we try to facilitate an industry statement, a food industry statement, where businesses can be on board and can endorse this statement that contains many similar elements for example, your guidelines, and where business showed the support for a strong sustainable food system law and show their support to have some long-term vision to have a European transition towards sustainable food system. So actually the statement is also open to retailers like restaurants. And if any one of you is interested to participate, we will be very happy to share it with you. And and I think that it's not an easy task to reach out and to influence policymaker, but I think you can try to have those guidelines published and try to meet with policymakers directly and with the commission and MEPs as well.
Thanks, Julia. Thank you. Great to hear the work that WWF are doing, obviously, in this space. I know WWF have been working on this stuff for years. I mean, it sounds like we should be collaborating because we're asking for very similar things. So we'll maybe chat about that offline. And it sounds like you should be talking to Susan as well if you're collaborating with the private sector. So that's the perfect opportunity for me to say hello, Susan. I'll hand over to you.
Hi, thanks, Will. And actually, we've already been in touch, Julia and I, about this. So absolutely. So thank you also from me for inviting me back again to this final session to see the guidelines. And I think most of them are spot on. And I mean, in fact, there's only so much we can do if policy doesn't change. And we need, you know, that alignment across governments and countries where possible as well. So, I mean, food system changes are so, so important to Compass Group and to our clients and consumers, although some of them don't really appreciate that yet. And, you know, we're serving 5.5 billion meals a year. And as I also pointed out at our first round table, every meal we serve is an opportunity to drive change. So it's massive for us and for our chefs. And one of our culinary priorities group-wide is sustainability and working towards achieving our climate commitments for 2030 and 2050 by embedding a sustainability-focused culinary culture. So, I mean, our wonderful chefs, who are the real magicians and ambassadors in the business, have that complex task of reformulating the meals to ensure that they're delicious and exciting, as well as climate friendly, so which are the things that you went through at the beginning as well of the session. And we absolutely need them to select the right products for those meals and end up with as little food waste as possible, as well as educating our clients and consumers as they go. So, you know, and the right products include all the factors mentioned in these guidelines, like the local, seasonal and plant-based produce that are from more sustainable farming or production methods, or products that have a positive social impact, helping people to have a better life. So, you know, and as Duncan also said earlier, it's not a high margin sector. So our chefs also have to carry on looking at the costs and the impacts on the bottom line. So obviously getting the right taxes, the subsidies and the funding in place is key for that. I mean, for example, we're implementing a whole bunch of new systems to help us with like the emissions reporting, the food waste tracking, and it will all help the chefs reformulate their menus and have the biggest impact possible. They'll be able to see which items are having the biggest impact. So I think that's just so crucial to be able to demonstrate it to our clients and our investors as well. So, you know, we're always focused on developing our chefs. And as you know, I've also got a good number of chefs signed up for the Climate Smart Chefs courses that you're organizing through this project. And it would be amazing if there could be more of those courses available to our chefs that we could all benefit from. so the contract caterers and restaurants as well. And where possible in different languages would be superb as well. I could go on forever about all of this, but I mean, just how can we get these messages through to policymakers? So Compass Group, together with three other EU contract catering groups, we form part of an organization called Food Service Europe that also includes members from other contract catering associations from various EU member states. And Food Service Europe's priorities include very similar themes, so public procurement, an EU code of conduct on responsible food business, taxation, sustainability. So, you know, all relevant topics to include these messages in. And they provide direct input to EU policy proposals. Then I think, you know, most of our country MDs, and I'm sure our competitors as well, also play an important part in their local catering associations. So again, you know, sharing this information with them is a really great way of getting these messages across to the local governments and authorities. And apart from this, our chefs and their teams are serving meals every day to a good number of EU institutions themselves. So can also interact with the clients and the consumers and raise the awareness at that level too. So I think lots of different levels there that the messaging can get through it.
Thanks, Susan. Super interesting. I had no idea that Food Service Europe was a thing. So that's brilliant to hear about that. And it feels like an avenue that's worth pursuing. And you make a really good point that your clients are also influencers on policymakers. So every meal is an opportunity. So whoever does the catering in Brussels, that's they need to find out who that is, and they can split little messages and lunch. Davide, let's move to you. I'd really like to hear your thoughts, because you've done a lot of work at the city level as well as a broader level. So I'll hand over to you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much, Will, and for having me here today. And thanks to Julia and Susan for their inspiring words. Just to quickly introduce myself once again, I worked for several years as a food policy officer at the municipality of Bergamo. In 2021, we launched a program aimed at engaging cooks and restaurants across the city. And we basically challenged them to implement a number of sustainable practices, particularly to include more sustainable plant-rich dishes and to their menus. Recently, I joined the environmental NGO Essere Animali, where my work focuses particularly on an initiative named Meno per Più, which seeks to leverage the transformative power of cooks and food services to transition to sustainable food systems. So as well as WWF, we try to find synergies with food businesses and local authorities, and we try getting into their canteens. We help them redefine their menus, improve recipes, and communicate it properly to workers and stakeholders. So getting to the topics of today's roundtable, the first thing that comes to my mind when getting through these guidelines is that everything is connected. Current food systems are clearly fueling several crises, and we need integrated and coherent policies that drive this systemic change that we need at all levels, European, national, and local level, of course. These policies must be really comprehensive and address both the structural factors affecting food systems and some smaller issues, more industry specific, more local, that are preventing change. So in other words, I believe that we cannot think of fixing one single issue without looking at the whole picture. So just So the way, basically the way we eat today is unsustainable. Too much waste, too much animal protein. We don't know where our food is sourced from. We don't know who produced it, when it was produced, how it was produced. So we really need to reconnect people with food, and we need to get people more conscious about what they put on their plate. So in this sense, we need a general shift, and cooks are key allies in accelerating this transition, given the high number of diners who eat out of their home every day. As well, I think that today's offerings in restaurants are too often very poor and absolutely inadequate in terms of taste, relative cost, emphasis in the menus, and so on. Cooks and restaurants are key actors of change, and as they are responsible for making sustainable dishes great and tasty and appreciated and eaten, especially. So just to get back to the guidelines, I think the institutions at all levels should encourage the adoption of sustainable practices by lowering the bureaucracy and the costs of any type linked with this transition. Virtuous restaurants should be given more opportunities and incentives, financial incentives, but in general, incentives to continue on their sustainable path, while also making unsustainable alternatives relatively more expensive in terms of money, in terms of time, access, etc. So I'm clearly talking about the need for reshaping food environments, starting from public food procurement, for instance, adopting policy measures like mandatory food procurement criteria for collective and public catering. And I saw that there's a specific, is mentioned into the guidelines, the need for this. Another key aspect, which I want to quickly highlight, is the need for education and training. Chefs, as we already said, oftentimes don't have the knowledge about the relationship between food and climate change, for instance, and might be also unfamiliar with some cooking techniques that are not included in the traditional chef training courses. It's really important, especially if we are to get people, diners, familiar with some ingredients that are not currently familiar with, like beans, seeds, nuts, tofu, and other, you know, meat substitutes. So to conclude, I think these guidelines contains a lot of interesting proposals covering all different dimensions of food systems. These guidelines, I think, should be really considered to be translated into policies and into the upcoming sustainable food system framework. And as a food policy officer and also food activist, I fully support this piece of work, and I'm really looking forward to see what's next. Thank you.
Thanks, David. That's super interesting. We've got a few minutes still, so I'm just trying to piece together everything that's been said and come up with some intelligent questions. My feeling is what we're saying collectively here is there are opportunities to influence policy at lots of different levels, and actually it can be different people influencing policy at those levels. So at a local level, getting consumers more excited about sustainable diets and things like that, and demanding better food is perhaps a way to do it, whereas you're unlikely to get an individual marching on Brussels with a protest sign demanding sustainable food. So there might be a different kind of intervention needed there. I'm just interested in in how that works. So Julia, for example, when at WWF, you do a lot of campaigns and some are engaging with citizens and some are directly engaging with policymakers. Do you tend to go for the big ticket items with the EU, like subsidies and the you know the whatever the common agricultural policy may become in the future and then all the farm to fork and all of that piece? But then when it comes to engaging on incentives for the businesses, is that a national state issue rather than an EU issue? How do we sort of navigate that in your opinion?
Thanks for the question. It's a very interesting aspect, actually. So one of the reasons we think that, for example, this framework law is extremely important is that it can set a really long-term vision, and it can have it can set a direction also for the business, and it can unlock other kind of investment funds and incentives. We are hoping to see something. Oh, okay. Probably I will be optimistic saying that, but what we were hoping is to see something, a transformative action and a transformative engagement as it was for the energy sector, for example, that really unlock many incentives also for the industry and tried to align all the policies, all the existing policies to this kind of objectives. So that's why it is very important to have a long-term vision with also objectives, clear objectives and targets. So all the policy mix can go after that, including incentives and other kind of funds that are a bit also beside the common agricultural policy that it's so difficult to change and to move forward. It's a very it's something that we are exploring to see what kind of other funds can be moved in order to support the food business sectors. But I think more than us as NGO, I think the business is more involved in that. Also because the European Commission is really trying to set higher standard and a higher bar for sustainability, for example, with the corporate sustainability due diligence policy that really require business to assess their environmental impact. So I think the direction is already setting in different aspects, but really we need something for food specifically and for the food and agricultural sector that is quite lacking at the moment. So we were really hoping that this law would help to fill that gap, but maybe I'm too optimistic, I have to say.
Well, I don't know. I hope you're not too optimistic. A policy change takes a long time, doesn't it? And
yeah.
Exactly. You're right. There has been quite a few changes recently. The in the EU, the due diligence on deforestation and supply chains is fairly recent, and that took a long time to become law, and it affects the businesses quite strongly, doesn't it? So I guess Susan, for you as an individual company, and maybe also as a member of Food Service Europe, do you tend to engage at an EU level, or does it work more effectively for you to create change on a local level, so working with public procurement standards on a national level and things like that?
I think, you know, we work at all levels, really, because I think, you know, you need to be able to nudge behaviour. You need to be able to do that, like starting with the youngsters at school, as you said earlier as well, you know, so it's really not just the local authorities, but everybody that needs to change their habits. So, I mean, for example, for Compass, obviously the EU legislation on the due diligence and the CSRD is a huge change, and a very complex one that, you know, we're spending a lot of time on assessing, doing gap analyses and things of what we're reporting now, what we will have to report going forward and things like that. But I think it's a good step in the right direction. The only problem is that there's sort of similar legislations in other parts of the world, but not quite the same, you know. So that means obviously you've got to align different countries to different things, which doesn't help either. And even within one country, you know, one region could be doing something different to another region. So that again makes it even more complex. So I think, I had a really good example the other day from one of our countries who'd been talking to the local authorities because it was on the theme of food waste. And they have to do a number of tests, obviously for food safety tests. So they have to have a certain number of samples for every kind of meal that they serve each day. And the problem with that is that, of course, all that food then goes to waste straight away once it's been tested. And what they've done by talking to the authorities about it is they've actually been able to reduce the weight of those food samples by 60%. So that's a huge amount. And it means that the overall food waste in a year can be reduced by almost 100 tons.
Wow.
Which is a huge amount, you know. And that's just from food samples that are required by the local authorities.
Yeah, wow.
So it just shows what can be done, you know, if you talk to the local authorities and try and come to agreements with them.
Yeah, that's fascinating. Well done, ma'am. I guess what it shows also is that specific business problems or business challenges to a sustainability agenda can't necessarily be solved at the EU level because they may be unique to the legislation and the business framework for that company.
Correct.
On the ground. And I guess that's where maybe this sort of citizen engagement also works, David. I mean, citizens, one of our roles, and fortunately, is we have a democratic process and we can vote for things, can't we? So is that an opportunity for local elections and things like that, David?
Yeah, I want to share a couple of thoughts. One is about the central role of food within a city. I mean, food is intercepts different domains, different areas, and is an entry point for achieving a number of different policy priorities at local level. So as a food policy officer, this my job was also to raise awareness among my policymakers about the importance, the relevance of the food topic, and the need to really work on this topic also at the local level. Bergamo is part of the Milan Urban Food Policy Pact, which is a network of more than 200 cities committed to the transition to sustainable food systems, and is a great platform to exchanging knowledge and experiences and good practices and be stronger together. We know that there are many there are a lot of opportunities to improve lives of people, of citizens, through food. I'm talking about food, food security, and talking about food waste, and talking about urban gardening, and talking about education in schools and farmers markets and so on. So as a city, I believe that cities has a really, really a central role, and at the European level, they really should keep into consideration how, you know, overarching policies at the European level are then translated at a local level. And so what I you know, I hope is a stronger collaboration between, you know, different levels of authorities. And as a NGO representative, I mean, the role of NGOs is to, you know, keep this work going on and try to, you know, keep all these actors all together. And that's it. I really liked what Susan said at the beginning, that every meal is an opportunity. This is really right, because it's not a challenge, it's a battle, it's a fight, and we really need to fight on every meal and get into, you know, the right track. So yeah, thank you.
Thanks, Davide. Yes, absolutely. Every meal is an opportunity, and that's a really good point about the local action. If the people you're engaging with locally are networked, like the Milan Urban Food Pact and things like that, actually that can spread quite quickly and influence a lot of places without having to reinvent the wheel every time, I guess. Super interesting. I've learned a ton of stuff in the last 20 minutes. So thank you, all three of you. I don't know, Duncan, if we want to have a quick open the floor to anyone who's...
Yeah, we've got a couple of minutes. If anyone's got any questions, that'd be great.
I know we've got quite a few chefs here who've been on our training course already. So I don't know if chefs have got any questions about how you might be able to influence things. I'm not putting anyone on the spot, don't worry. Andrea, we can answer that question. So we are running our training courses, obviously. With the fourth edition of the training course is just finishing in the next few weeks. And then we've got a pause over the summer and then they start again. So we're kind of halfway through. So we've trained about 80 chefs already on the training course. So bang on target, and had some good feedback to keep improving it, which is one of the aims, is at the end of this course, end of this project, there'll be the possibility of replicating a training course across Europe that's been tested by lots of chefs.
Exactly, Will. I don't know if you can hear me.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yep.
Okay. Yeah, so I think Will answered the question better than me. We have chefs from all over Europe for all of ages, so yeah.
Yeah, so to answer the question about the other countries, yeah, we're aiming to get a chef from all 27 countries on the course. So we're nothing if not inclusive. If anyone wants to find out about more about the course, just let us know. I think everyone's gone quiet and shy, so we're probably at the end of any questions. The three panelists, you're off the hook. No tricky questions coming. So well done, and thank you ever so much for your time. Really appreciate it. Duncan, back to you.
Yes, thank you. Thank you so much. That was absolutely fascinating. Susan, Julia, David, and Will, that was brilliant. I really, really enjoyed that. I learned lots myself. So thank you so much for that. And yeah, and again, I also love the idea that we can all change the food system and fix the climate three meals a day. So we have three opportunities a day. It's brilliant. It's a really positive way of doing it, and quite an exciting way of doing it. And I just want to just leave you with a thought I had, because when I first started working on sustainable food back in 2008, this wouldn't have happened. You all wouldn't have been here. Companies really weren't involved in food systems. It was all about production. There was no NGOs on it, and we were one of the first. I was working at WWF at the time. It really was seen as an alien concept, and let alone having a discussion around changing policy at national or EU level. So to have all of you wonderful people here, I think we should see as a really positive process, because in 15 years the narrative has changed. People are involved. People like Compass are involved. Cities are involved. More and more NGOs are getting involved, even though it's a little bit outside of their core remit, WWF Conservation Organization, working on nutrition. It's fantastic. So I think we should remember that in 15 years, we've come a lot further and a lot faster than those of us at the beginning of this journey would have thought it was possible to have to be. So I think it's great. And I think we should all be celebrating that, and we can really deliver the goals that we need. So yeah, so I'm just gonna finish off. We've got one final slide to share with you about what next. So I'm just gonna quickly touch on that for this. So this isn't the end. This is, as I said, the end of the beginning of the process. We will be completing these guidelines. We will be publishing them on the 5th of July at the midterm conference. Hopefully people, please join us then. It's an hour and a half. We're gonna hear from some interesting people. We're gonna unveil our vision, which we've co-created, and you'll have a chance to download the guidelines and really see what they are. It's on the 5th of July, so please sign up for it. Join us there, and if anyone thinks, yes, we want to contribute, please let me know. I'm always up for contributing with people and learning from everyone. As well as that, we also have the Climate Smart Chef Award, which will be presented on the 5th of July. And this will be explaining what this award is. This is very much something we hope that we're going to deliver through this program and also be one of our legacy projects. It's exciting. We're going to be we're going to have two categories of award for chefs, looking at chefs participating in the course, and also an award for local initiatives. It doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter whether you work for a big company, a small company, or you're a chef who does private parties. You're all invited to this. This is for anyone. We want to hear what people are doing, because this is a chance to really celebrate the best of what's out there and to demonstrate that sustainable, healthy, tasty food is possible. And let's reward the people who are doing this. So more info will be available soon at the climatesmartchef.eu website. So don't forget to visit that. And then finally, the really important bit for us is we have a network. Please join our network, get involved. As when we have had our midterm conference, that's when the hard work begins. That's when we are going to start engaging with policymakers at every level. We want to work with businesses. So please, if you see an opportunity, you want us to get involved in anything, please do it. We will help. If you think, yes, someone needs to hear from what they're doing, let that person know. We will try and do it. We will have an outreach. We are going to be keen to get in front of as many people as possible and to work with everyone here to deliver the goals of this. And then hopefully in that 18 months, with your feedback, explore what next. How do we deliver this beyond the scope of this project? Because our vision is 2030. This project ends at the end of 2024. So we're going to have another 5 years of hard work, which I hope all of you can help us with and will guide us in that process, taking that forward. So on that note, we are dead on time. So thank you so much for Ale, Alessio, and all the other people behind the scenes who have been keeping us to time, have been driving this forward so well. I think you've all done a brilliant, brilliant job. Don't forget to register for the conference. I would love to have your feedback. I really would. I think it'd be so valuable to hear about what we can do and what we can do better and what we've done well. Thank you very much. Have a wonderful late afternoon, early evening. Enjoy it. And yes, I look forward to seeing you on the 5th of July. So goodbye for now.
Thanks, everyone. Bye-bye.
Thanks. Bye-bye.
Thank you very much. Bye.
Hi, everybody.
Bye, Evie.
Bye. Thank you.